seated. Grab your Bibles, whether you have it by tablet, whether you have it by open page, or by your phone. And let's declare together, Lord, I thank you that I have a Bible. It is my personal copy of basic instruction before leaving earth. I am a believer, not a doubter. I'm not just a hearer, but I'm also a doer. And I'm so glad that I have your word. And as a result of your word, my life is much better. So I declare that as a result of your word, that as I hear your word, that I'm going to leave here better than I came here, in Jesus' name. You all sound wonderful. Give God thanks one more time. He's so faithful. Beloved, if you would join me in just one text, I'm not going to make you glad twice. Glad to see me come and glad to see me go. Zechariah chapter 3. I was praying when I got the call, and the Lord immediately dropped the word in my hand, because, as you know, beloved, it is the desire of the enemy, and I don't want to give him more credit than he deserves. But it is the desire of the enemy to discredit men and women of God. It is the desire of the enemy to take us down, to destroy us, and knowing that he can't do anything without God's permission, he wants to use us against ourselves. There is no vessel of God, especially me, that could stand before anybody, claim perfection in the flesh, or claim that I'm all and everything. And yet I understand that the grace and the forgiveness and the love of God reigns in the earth. And I praise him for that. But the enemy wants to cause there to be such interruption in gifts of God that you, even when the enemy can't take you out, you move to take yourself out. That your sin, that your mistakes, that your problems, that your insufficiencies, he wants to magnify those so much so that you tell God, I know you called me, but I cannot fulfill the call because things are too far gone and I am in too deep. But I'm so glad that God has a remedy for the word today, is to bless us to understand that God has something in store for those who love him. Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. If you have it in your Bible, signify by saying word. And he showed me, verse 1, my God, out of Zechariah 3, Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand, the hand of authority to resist him. And the Lord said unto Satan, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan. Even the Lord that hath chosen Jerusalem rebuke thee. Is not this a brand plucked out of the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and stood before the angel. And he answered and spake unto those that stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And unto him he said, behold, I have caused thine iniquity pass from thee, and I will clothe thee with the change of raiment. And I said, let them set a fair meter upon his head. So they set a fair meter upon his head and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord stood by. Beloved, I want to talk from the topic, the power of protecting the brand. The power of protecting the brand. Real quick quiz. When you look at Kenneth O. Robinson Jr., what do you think of? One word must come to your mind that details his calling, his purpose, the anointing on his life, and the favor by which God gives him to move in and out among men in the earth. Beloved, if you don't know it, you must use the board behind me. God blessed him to be one that is not only a dreamer, but calls others to dream, and not only dream, but see the fulfillment of dreams. In all of our effort as men and women of God to try to be everything to all people, we know that, beloved, that will never happen. So the Lord causes us to keep it simple and brings us to a place that we are effective in the thing that he called us to do. And that thing that God calls us to do becomes the brand by which God causes us to be known by. So, beloved, I want you to begin to understand that we've come to realize that the enemy of our soul, being the liar that he is, the deceiver that he is also an accuser of the brethren. When I declare and discuss this thing about destroyer and a liar and all that the Lord even called him in John 10, when Jesus identified him as a thief, Jesus identified Satan as a liar. Jesus identified Satan as the father of lies, but we also understand that he is an accuser, or as our text renders in other versions, an opposer. The enemy comes, my Lord, to take the gift and the calling of a man and woman of God and has settled in that he can't stop God, but he's determined to stop you. So what he does is stand against you to oppose you at every turn. He causes there to be accusations that come against men and women of God, not necessarily from people, but many of you, if you would know the times that we may be asleep, or the times that a pastor or a man or woman of God can be just sitting in solitude, and the enemy comes with accusations saying, you can't serve God because of this, and you can't be used by God because of that, and you can't stand before God's people because of this and because of the other thing. And he constantly accuses before God. Many of you may not understand this or may not know this, but this is something that the devil does. He even approaches God on a regular basis to accuse the servants of God and attempt to tell God, so-and-so is not qualified to be used, or so-and-so is not qualified to be blessed. And he brings up accusations because he is an accuser of the brethren. And his chief goal is to oppose. His chief goal is to oppose. That's why we see in Zechariah 3, you all with me, Satan doing what he do. He's accusing. In Zechariah chapter 3, he's accusing Joshua the priest. But notice the words and the actions that were taken, and we're going to praise God. First of all, we see the advocacy of God. Everybody say, God is our advocate. My God, on Joshua's behalf, Satan is rebuked. That means he is divinely put in his place. Man, we can stop right there. Because, beloved, yes, we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but the mercies of God, the forgiveness of God, when we come to him, he says, come boldly to the throne of grace where you can find grace and obtain mercy in time of need. So when we go to God, he casts our sins into the sea of forgetfulness, but the devil don't forget, and he tries to use our stuff against us and cause there to be an occasion to accuse. But we see God put him in his place and said, the Lord rebuke you. He didn't waste a lot of words. He said, the Lord rebuke you. He said, you got something to say, but the Lord rebuke you. So I thank God today that somebody understands that God is our advocate. Number two from the text, we understand that a new identity was spoken over Joshua the priest. My God, by the act of the angel picking a brand out of the fire, that name was then given to Joshua the priest when Joshua told the accuser that he is God, and God told the accuser that Joshua is a brand plucked out of the fire. Now, I know a lot of us don't understand all these terms from time to time, but a brand plucked out of the fire can start other fires. A brand plucked out of the fire, my God, can be applied to something that is maybe miles away, my God, and blown by the wind. But if a fire was in one location, a brand can move to another and start a fresh fire. I heard the testimonies that many of you talked about how you came here needing restoration. God was showing you the perfect example of the power of a brand, that because you needed something restored in your life, the fire from Ken Robinson ignited some fire in you. So a brand, somebody say a brand. Plucked from the fire. So he got a new identity. So understand, number three, beloved, I rejoice over this. They then gave Joshua the priest my God, a change of garment. Change of garment. You notice the text said he had on dirty clothes. He was filthy. My God, beloved, all of us have come to God with dirty clothes and filthy. But aren't you glad that the Lord don't leave you dirty and filthy? He changes your clothes. He gives you, in essence, a new identity. God have mercy. And he gives you a new wardrobe, or somebody say an upgrade. You can't come to God and not be upgraded. Then number four from the text we see, not only was he upgraded, but his identity, the work of the ministry, and his calling was reaffirmed, because you see them put a fair meter upon his head. Now, not to get too theological or historical, but the meter, beloved, was the garment of the priest that was put on his head to determine who he was and to designate the people that wondered who he was. And what happened was, and many of you don't know this, the garment was wrapped from a cloth that was 8 feet long. God have mercy. The number 8 in scripture denotes new beginnings. So when the priest's meter was wrapped and put on the head of the priest, that signified this is a ministry of new beginnings, a reaffirmation of the power of the brain. Then number 5, that blessed me. From this text, it says that there was protection that was secured from further assault from the words in the mouth of the enemy. Because you see, the text goes on to say that after the meter was put on his head, the angel of the Lord stood by. And I want you to get a mental picture that he stood by with arms folded, saying, I wish you would say something else. He stood by in a posture to tell all accusing voices of the enemy, I know what happened. I know what he did. I know his failures. But now that I have changed his garment, now that I have reaffirmed his calling, now that I have identified him as a vessel of honor, there is nothing valid you could ever say against him. You might as well keep quiet and know that the Lord rebuke you. So by the angel standing there, it was like a divine bodyguard. A divine hitman, if you will. I wish you would. I don't want to say nothing derogatory, but I wish you would. I mean, he stood there and said, I wish you would. That signified the protection and the divine impartation of God. Can I hurry along here? Beloved, I need you to understand on this occasion that God calls and chooses his servant. The Bible says many are called, but few are. Now, in order to be one of the few that are chosen, you have to choose a choice. I'm going to say it on this side because I don't think y'all heard me over here. I got a little affirmation over here. I think you have to choose a choice. What you talking about? God calls you, but because you are a free moral agent, you can still do what you want to do. You can still operate under the I'm going to do my thing mentality. And you can totally discard the call of God. But you must understand that what you don't accept, you are still accountable for. And understand, beloved, that when God calls you, your response ought to be, I don't understand everything you want to do with me. I don't understand it. I'm sure I'm not going to like it. But my sole response is yes. I may not like the process. I may not like the suffering. I may not like what people think of me. I may not like the friends I lose and the folk that use me. But Lord, you said you got me, and my response is yes. So God calls and chooses his servants. And his servants choose the choice. God have mercy. And God invests vision and purpose. So we just won't be walking around saying, I'm a man of God. All right, prove it. So there must be vision and purpose, so you'll be like a toned and a honed tool that knows why he's here, so you won't buy into other suggestions about what your purpose is. when you invest and are invested in by God, he is clear as to what he wants to do with you. He's not clear all the time with the methodology, but he is clear with the end result. Oh, God, have mercy. Beloved, God, by the work of the Holy Spirit, causes there to be a walking out of the steps of the path that the vessel has been designated. So we may not know the end, but we know the path. Grab somebody by the hand and say, we walk by faith and not by sight. So the faith that we're talking about is, Lord, I don't know the way, but I know you. I may not always understand your process, but I trust you. I may not always catch this, like the way you do what you do, but I love you. So the Lord orders our steps, and the steps of a righteous man are always ordered by the Lord. I'm trying to hurry along here, but the Lord causes us to walk along the path and get in the steps, and it's the work of the Holy Ghost as we walk this path, hear me, beloved, to be able to be branded by the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm going to use this interchangeably because many of you that have pledged or whatever, you understand what it means to be branded. Many that came from the Midwest or your uncle's cattle farm understand what it means to be branded. Many of you that saw Good Western understand what it means to be branded. That an iron with an insignia on it would be stuck in the fire and heated till it was red and then slightly cooled, and then it would be placed on a conspicuous place on the skin to be a mark of identification. My God, beloved, it would be able to be discerned by people that say, all right, I want to know who he is. Who is he branded by? So the brand would represent who owns you, where you come from, and what you're associated with. Oh God, that's one understanding of the word brand. But now we come to understand that the brand is also identifying why I'm here. And the Holy Ghost has a responsibility to brand us so that when you go through times that shake you and you might bump your head and forget, just look at the brand. Oh, come on now. Look at the brand and remember the pain that caused it to come on you. Look at the brain and remember the process that somebody may have had to hold you down in order to sear it in, but the end result is there. So I need somebody to look at somebody and say, I don't know what you've been through. I don't know the times you bumped your head. I don't know the times things happen that you may not like, but I got a word for you. The Lord has branded you. You belong to him. And when you forget who you are, look at the brand. The brand, identifying characteristics of God's servants, of his vessels. Again, it is the work of the Holy Ghost to brand the vessel. Satan seeks to oppose and hinder and destroy the brand by way of several things. Can I preach now? He causes there to be misunderstanding. One of his chief tools to disfigure purpose and to disqualify vessels is to get folk to not understand the vessel. He muddies the water of the vessel so that when people come to drink from the ministry, they say it looks this way, but it ain't that way. Because the enemy wants to cause there to be confusion between what is presented and what is accepted. What is ministered and what is received. So he wants to muddy the understanding of the brand and cause there to be confusion about the purpose. Why do that? I'll tell you in a minute. Also, the enemy wants there to be a magnification of faults and flaws and sin. Look at somebody and tell them, I ain't perfect, nor are you. Now, you might tell somebody, I might be more perfect than you, but we ain't going to talk about that. But after we all been working out, nobody smell good. Y'all going to catch that in a minute. After we all have had stuff going in our lives and God is working in us, working stuff out of us, and we working out trying to figure it out, everybody sweat. Y'all go get that. So what the enemy does is want to make you think you stinking, and you're going to look at somebody else who also stinking, and because you want to cover up your stink, you're going to say to them that stink, I don't stink as much as you. But we all been lifting weights and the sweat pouring down. Pastor cracked me up sometime when he put on Facebook his live videos of his workout. And beloved, as much as I love him, and that's my brother, I don't want to be around him after the workout. And you sure enough don't want to be around me after the workout. There must be a fellowship with soap and water that comes before. But what the enemy wants us to do is forget that we all need soap and water. So when folk come to church, they're looking for a perfect pastor, looking for a perfect example. And I want to tell you, you'll be greatly disappointed because there is no one perfect but the Lord. And when we come, yes, there are standards that should be set. There are things that should not be. But beloved, if you're looking for perfection, it is the job of the brand to point you to the brand maker. The enemy wants to magnify to cut you off from seeing the brand maker. Why is that, Bishop? I'll tell you in a minute. I'm almost out. He wants to, number three, make the servant abdicate or abandon their assignment. Lord, I've been too deep. I've done too much. I can't make it. I've got too much problem. Lord, I failed too much. Everybody know my stuff. I've been through hell and high water. Been through the fire and the rain. Anybody ever sang this song? Some through the water. Some through the flood. Some through the fire. But we often forget that part. But all through the blood. Then some of us sing some through great sorrow. But God gives a song, you know. And we need to understand that, beloved. That the devil knows that he can't beat God. I want to say this before I get out of your way. God has no enemies. Because God has no equal. And the enemy can inflict same damage on you. Just like different countries that may have nuclear weapons. You push the button, I push the button. They have a policy, mutually assured destruction. Well, when it comes to God, there is nobody. They got a button bigger than here. There is nobody that has a power greater than here. So the devil may be a liar and a murderer and a thief, but he ain't no fool. So he knows he can't defeat God, so he sets his sights on defeating you. And he don't always use outside forces. He tries to use inside forces to make you just drop and quit. That's why when you go through stuff, you got to make a determination. I didn't bring myself here, and I'm not going to bring myself out. Had it not been for the Lord that was on my side. See, I've gotten to the place in my life that I understand, Lord, you're in charge, and that really means something. Lord, I've been in up places that I can't figure it out, so I've gotten to the place that I said, Lord, I trust you. Yes, there are things I understand, but there's a whole lot more I don't understand, and I'm leaving this thing in your hands. I want somebody to get a new understanding of Jesus, take the wheel, that you understand, Lord, you are driving my life because you're after something in me to bring something out of me, to cause that to be a praise unto you. But the enemy wants you to quit. He wants you to quit. He wants you to quit. He wants you to drop all that you've gone through, all that you've been through, all that you've gained up until this point. He wants you to forget the victories. He wants you to forget the overcoming. He wants you to forget my God, what came after the struggle? Because, beloved, I've lived long enough to recognize it don't last always. What I'm going through don't last always. What I'm suffering don't last always. The Lord got a way of bringing me out in his time and bringing me out with a shot of victory. I wonder if I got about 7 people in here that have been through the fire, been through the flood, been through hard trials, but there came a day when that stuff was over. Yeah. I need y'all to understand something, that the Lord knows when to do what he do. But see, the fact is, you got to hold on long enough to let him do what he do. Because the Lord knows how to bring you out. When you can't see your way, he's God. And what the enemy wants you to do is trap the process. But I need you to grab somebody by the arm and say, don't drop it now. You're almost to your destination. You're almost where you need to be. Can I get somebody to look at somebody and say, I feel strength coming now. I feel encouragement coming now. I feel help. When God calls a brand, he has a distinct reason for plucking it out of the fire. You notice God don't use no cold coals. God doesn't call a C-O-L-D, C-O-A-L. Cold coal can't cook nothing. Cold coal can't prepare nothing. It smells and it's a prepared substance with potential to do something, but it ain't ready because it ain't been set on fire. Show me a man. Show me a woman that have been branded enough that through the fire, and even when the fire goes out to our vision, there's still enough heat to cook. And all that needs to happen is some refiring up to bring that thing to its full purpose. When God calls a brand, he calls a brand because that brand has a distinct purpose. Not just for ministry, but for lives. I told you, I'll tell you why I'm saying that. He went through Kenneth O. Robinson II, Esquire, went through what he went through so that God can use him for you. No servant of God is called unto themselves. They're called to be prepared by every means necessary to be what you need them to be for the purpose of God. Therefore, I want y'all to help me preach and say, purpose produces vision. Vision requires provision. Provision produces tangibility. Tangibility promotes validity. Validity brings glory to God. What all that mean, preacher? If he didn't go through what he went through, none of y'all would be here today. If he didn't have the experiences that he had, none of us would be here today. And God has given you validity and tangibility so folk will be able to touch it and understand this is real ministry. Folk will be able to see the validity and know that for 26 years, got hit upside the head, got kicked in the rear, got pushed out and discarded. But I see a comeback. I see a stand up. I see a righteous vessel. Is there anybody here? Oh, is there anybody here that knows that when God has called a brand, he calls it through the fire. He calls it through the pain. He calls it through the sunshine. He calls it through the rain. But you must now say, because it's blessed me, I'm going to protect it. I got 5 minutes left. So what you talking about protecting? Well, God's brand is called and chosen. And hold on, Russ, I'm coming, brother. Y'all thank God for Brother Russ. He's the man among men. My God, if God calls a brand, and when a brand is chosen, that brand obeys God, and lives are destined to be changed for the better. Look at somebody and say, we're here because we've been changed for the better. Change. Come on, y'all, come on, testify. Everybody didn't get to come up here, but somebody say, I've been changed for the better. So what does that mean? I've been called to protect the brand. See, we got to learn to feed what feeds us. That's why we tithe. That's why we give. That's why we come to church. I've been blessed here. It ain't about obligation. It's about gratitude. I'm not what I was. I'm not where I was. I'm not who I was. Since I encountered the brand, I've been made better. Now, before some of y'all know, some of them sitting there looking at you, now, you tell me to worship a man. No. How many know that Bear aspirin is a brand? What's the purpose of Bear aspirin? That whatever's hurting you, it will cause it not to hurt no more. So don't be trying to get all spiritual and religious on me. He preaching a message of worship a brand called a man. No, you thank God for what the brand do. Because how many of you would still have a headache if it weren't for Bear or Aleve or Excedrin or Tylenol extra strength? All those things are brands. You take them liberally. Now it's time to take the brand liberally. So how do we protect it? We protect the brand, my God, in our thought life. Because just like the devil accuses the brand, he also tries to cause you to be accused and to become an accuser yourself. So in your mind, you fight those thoughts and say, I don't need Pastor. I don't need the gift he is to me. My God, what kind of fool am I? If I know my life has been drastically changed since I encountered his life, even if he did one thing, it's the one thing that made me better. So whenever the enemy comes against my head to think crazy stuff about the brand, I say, no, I'm going to protect it. Y'all quiet now. We must protect the brand by way of the words we speak. I know that there are times with Pastor Gilligan, you know, why he teach that, why he preach that, why he do that. I know this, I know that, I know the other. But see, beloved, understand by the words you speak, you're justified. By the words you speak, you're condemned. So we must understand, beloved, that the enemy wants to get accused, and he don't care who he used to accuse. So, beloved, we must protect our words. Thank God for the man of God. Oh, I heard his feet stink at night when he go to sleep. Well, buy him foot powder and pray for him. I heard he snore. Well, give him a breathe right strip and pray for him. Tell somebody be a solution, not a problem. How do we protect the brand? We protect the brand from on our knees. More can be accomplished by prayer than getting upset and walking out the door. I remember when stuff wasn't going right here and the enemy was fighting this ministry and the pastor and I were talking. He wouldn't mention names and nor would I. But we'd be in a situation and say, there are people that have left, but I'm standing strong. There are people that have walked away, but I'm standing strong. I'm so glad that somebody was protecting this man of God from their knees. Because when you give your life for people and people walk away, it rips at your heart. But I'm so thankful that somebody prayed this ministry through some of the toughest times it's ever experienced. Somebody prayed this ministry through some of the hard times it's ever had. And all you that prayed and are still praying are to know that God hears and answers prayer. You ought to be on your feet right now, thanking God that as you prayed for him, God's going to bless you. That as you lifted him up, God's going to lift you up. Can you see? Prayer, it causes God to have a justifiable reason to bless you. Prayer, it causes the enemy to understand you're not susceptible to his foolishness and his works. Prayer, it causes you to be able to attack the enemy from behind the fence of the power of God. pray and when we pray, even if God don't change situations, immediately he changes us. I'm so glad that when we pray, demons shake. When we pray, mountains are moved. When we pray, the opposition of the enemy is cast down. Can I get somebody to lift up holy hands and begin to thank God that somebody prayed, and because you prayed, the ministry is still here. See, I'm closing now. But how else do we protect the brain? We protect the brain from our actions of investment. What you're doing today, guess who is going to bless the more? The seed may leave my hand, but it will never leave my life. The sowing I give to appreciate my man of God, I'm setting up myself to receive a harvest, a blessing. Can I give y'all one more scripture? The Bible says in Ephesians 6 and 8, there is no good thing that any man does that God won't do the same for you. Because you're praying, because you're investing, because you're loving, because you're praying, guess who's going to get behind you and bless your ministry, bless your business, bless your endeavors? Is there anybody here that understands that when you bless the power of the brand, you understand the brand will bring a blessing on you? We protect the brand with our presence and application of the imparted word. Look at somebody and say, the king's honor is in the crowd. You all are honoring Pastor today because you're here. You could have stayed home, cooked your wings for the game. You could have stayed home and made your dip for the game. But how many of you understand? Ain't no game like the game of protecting the brand. I'm about to whoop the devil real good. I'm about to kick him all over the place, because I'm setting myself up for a real blessing from the Lord. Can you help me preach this and understand God is about to do something phenomenal in my life because I'm protecting the brand, because our God is faithful? Because when you are faithful over a few things, y'all don't hear what I'm saying. I'm coming to my close. Come on, Rusty, let's have some fun up in here. When you're faithful over a few things, God will make you ruler over many things. I need somebody to help me understand this is training ground for my prosperity. This is training ground for my blessing. How I treat him, how I treat her, is how God's gonna treat me. How I respect them, how I receive them, is how God's going to receive me. So I cannot miss opportunities to protect the brand. It ain't worshiping a man. It's setting me up to be blessed. I'm closing. Let me calm down. Let me just say this before y'all get mad. I'm closing because I got other things to do. But hear me right now. But that's one of the spirits that's over this country, especially over this state. We are not the producer of crabs just by physical means. One of the worst things that's over the state of Maryland is this crab pot mentality, that I can't praise or bless God for nobody else. I can't lift up somebody else when they're doing well. I got to pull them down to make them remember where they came from. The devil is a liar today, because when I lift up somebody else, God lifts me up. When I help somebody else, God helps me. Can I stand the day? And can I get get about 100 people to stand with me as I close and rebuke this crab mentality, rebuke this pot mentality, and decide I'm going to lift up somebody else so God can lift me up too. Remain standing. See, that's how God qualifies you for a blessing. When you have a chance to help somebody, did you? When you had a chance to lift somebody, did you? What better chance you got than today than to tell God, thank you that I've learned to protect the brand. And the power of protecting the brand is I'm going to be blessed. Y'all standing there looking at me. I just served you up a hot foot Sunday with nuts, extra chocolate, 5 bananas, whipped cream, all the fixings you can want. Y'all sitting there looking at me like this. I said, no, I'm on a diet. Well, I dismissed the diet. Enjoy what God has put before you. This blessed opportunity to feast off what you're about to get because you learn to protect the brain. Where pastor go, I go. I may never preach like him, but if I push the brand, when he stand before God and get blessed, guess who else gonna get the same bless? I want you to understand it's time in these days to protect the brand. Because the brand has yet to give all that God has given. 26 years, the greatest days of your ministry, Dream Life, is ahead of you. Can we consider that everything coming now is because we survived what went? Y'all hear what I said? Everything coming now is because we survived what went. It was designed to kill you, but it made you stronger. It was designed to destroy you, but it made you more grateful. As you hear today, beloved, as I close, I'm done. I'm about 6 minutes over time. Forgive me. I owe you 6 minutes. Every eye closed and every head raised. Don't bow your head. We're not at a funeral. Come on. Lift your head up. How you going to dream with your head down? The power of the brand is about to impact your life. God uses a man because if God did it himself without a man, then you can make excuses about disqualifying yourself because you can't identify with God without his use of a man. Our sin has made us unreceptive to the holiness of God. So God makes a man a brand to introduce his holiness through a man so you can also receive it for you because you are a man. So the basic understanding is if God did it for him, he can also do it for me. If God did it through him, God can also do it through me. So as you lift your heads, I want you to declare, I'm without excuse. Lord, I'm without excuse. Because you're ready to bless me more than I've ever imagined. I may not like the process. Y'all not declaring. Y'all saying it real mealy mouth. Y'all scared or something? Y'all think I'm going to tell you to give your firstborn and drink some Kool-Aid from the vat? No, no. I want you to declare, I'm about to get blessed. More than I am right now. I've connected with a ministry. I've connected with a brand. I'm going to protect it. I'm going to respect it. I'm going to receive from it. Because God got more for me. And I declare the greatest days of my life are ahead of me. Now lift up your hands and begin to thank God for what you lived through. Come on, thank God for what you live through. Because if it could have killed you, it would have killed you. Father, as a man of God, as a prophet of your word, I declare over this house, Lord God, that because of the faithfulness of this man and woman of God, Lord, because of those who have dared to declare and to love them and respect them in this way and give them honor, I pray a double blessing, a hundredfold return over every effort, over every gift, over every seed sown. I pray, oh God, that the anointing will flow in this house even greater. Lord, I thank you, Lord God, that every empty seat is about to be filled with more worshipers. Everybody, Lord God, is about to get a spirit of evangelism like they never had before. They're going to represent a brand of dreamers that have never hence been represented before. This house will represent a brand of people that will bring to pass the word of the Lord that declares, oh God, that your thoughts towards us are thoughts of good, not of evil, to bring us an expected end. Thank you, Lord, for the great days ahead. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings ahead. We're not doom and gloom. We're blessing and glory unto the only God. And we declare it right now in Jesus' name. Come on, worship God. Don't clap. Don't clap. Open your mouth and worship God. Come on, open your mouth and bless God. Come on, by the Spirit of the living God. Thank God for the brand. Thank God for the brand. Thank God for the brand. Thank God for what he's doing in your life. A new thing, a new anointing, a new fervor. Them do the altar call, but before they come to do anything else, thank God for your man of God who's opened you up to be blessed. Thank God for this house that is a conduit of blessing. Oh, come on, church, you can do better than this.
Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Amen. I know this is a foundation. I'm sorry, a founder's celebration service, but we are still a church, amen? And ministry must go on. And so what better opportunity than now to rebrand yourself? Not in of your own self, but to be branded by God. And so you might be here this morning and you, they have what are called a generic brand. Generic brand is not like a authentic or a genuine brand, as he mentioned. And so today is an opportunity for you to give your life to Christ and to be branded under the ministry and under the blood of Jesus. So today, if you're here and you say, I'm one, I want to be rebranded. I've been trying to brand myself and it's not quite working out the way I planned it. Things are not going the way that I planned. And so you are tossed to and fro. Would you come at this time? Don't even think about it. A lot of times when you think, that's when you go wrong. So if that's you, just come down to the altar right now. I know this might be untraditional, but just come. Just come right now. If you're here and you say, well, I need to be rebranded. I've been going through some things. I've been having some trials and tribulations, and I want to rebrand myself, but I want to do it under the blood. Don't think about it. Just come. Just come. We're here. We're here. We're here. Just come. If you are here and you said, listen, I've got away from the things of God. I've walked away from God. I've walked away from the church. We're here to serve you. We're here to bless you.